Hello everyone, welcome to today's live broadcast, Duplex Screening of GPCRs to Measure Calcium and Beta-Arrestin. I'm Christina Jewell of Labroots and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We're delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by Labroots and sponsored by DiscoverX. DiscoverX is an innovative company that develops, manufactures, and commercializes reagents, complete cell-based assay kits, profiling and screening services, as well as other turnkey solutions for the drug discovery, screening, and life science markets. Their biochemical and cell-based assays enable customers to improve research productivity and effectiveness of their screening, lead optimization and SAR campaigns, thus accelerating the discovery and development of new drugs. Plus, with the addition of BioMap platform of human primary cell systems for phenotypic profiling, DiscoverX offers a powerful tool to deliver physiologically relevant insights and integrated solutions for all stages of discovery, from target and lead discovery to preclinical and beyond. For more information, please go to www.discoverx.com. We have a few important announcements before we begin. This webcast is designed to be interactive, and we encourage you to ask questions during the event. You can submit questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. We will try to answer as many questions as we can. You can enlarge the slide window by clicking on the screen icon in the lower right-hand corner of the slide window. If you have any technical problems viewing or hearing this presentation, please click on the support button at the top right of your presentation window, or you can submit your problem through the green Q&A button on the lower left. This is an educational webinar and thus offers free continuing education credits. After the webinar is over, please click on the CE button located at the bottom left-hand corner of your webpage and follow the process of obtaining your credits. I would now like to introduce today's speaker, Thierry Calmels, PhD. Dr. Calmels is currently heading the Molecular and Cellular Pharmacology Department at Bioproject Biotech with a focus on neuroscience and inflammation therapeutic areas. Dr. Calmels' main research focus is on G-protein coupled receptors, GPCRs, with the aim of setting up screening and secondary assays as well as to dissect their signaling mechanisms for proposed drug targets. Dr. Calmels has specialized in implementing calcium mobilization assays for GPCRs in drug discovery, as well as for human iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes in cardiac safety. Dr. Calmels got his PhD in applied genetics at the University of Toulouse in France, after which he moved to Pittsburgh, California for a postdoc in pharmacology with Dr. Jay Lazo. After spending 3 years in Pittsburgh, Dr. Calmels joined the Molecular Oncology Department with Professor D. Stihelin at the Pasteur Institute in Lille, France, followed by 5 years at GlaxoSmithKline within the cardiology unit before joining BioProject in 2001. I will now turn it over to Dr. Calmels for his presentation. Dr. Calmels?
Hi everybody, and thank you for your introduction. When working on GPCR in a pharmaceutical company, we are facing issues related to the multiple signaling assays we have to run to characterize ligands and eventually identify bisignaling. We had the objective to develop a duplex assay capable of studying calcium and beta-arrestin signaling from a single well. I'm going to share with you today the work with the histamine H1 receptor we have initiated in collaboration with DiscoverX and Hamamatsu companies. Before to start, I would like to give some information about my company. Bioproject, I should say in French, is a French independent and privately owned research company. Main focus are ligands of GPCR, histamine, dopamine, etc. and peptidase inhibitors with potential therapeutic applications in different fields. So far, we have 7 drugs on the market, 3 drugs in phase 3, and 2 drugs in phase 1 clinical trials in gastroenterology, cardiovascular, and CNS. Very recently, the H3 antagonist WAKIX, petrelizumab, received EMA marketing authorization for the treatment of narcolepsy. I would like to thank the contributors to this study, Bioprojet with Sabine Rouanet, Stéphane Krief and Isabelle Bertrand, from Jean-Marc D'Angelo from Hamamatsu, and Andy Green from DiscoverX. There are current approaches and limitations that can be identified when working with GPCR. GPCR receptor signaling is diverse and often with complex pharmacology occurring concurrently following receptor activation. The majority of assays individually probe endpoints, which may require several complex methods and parallel experiments to fully understand the system. The ability to measure multiple endpoints in a single assay plate and preferably from a single clone is desirable. This multiplexing approach could potentially provide cost saving and time efficiency. Which are some of the advantages of developing single plate dual calcium and beta-arrestin assay for a human GPCR receptor? Then first, dual data are obtained for the same treated cell in one plate, and this can be adaptable to high-throughput platform. It can be very helpful when ligands are available only in limited amounts. This can help to study biased ligands. Half of the number of cells are required for both assay, leading to cost and time saving. And it may facilitate good laboratory practice, performing, monitoring, recording, reporting, and archiving all laboratory studies. It may not be easier when setting up the procedure, but will save time and effort later on with the GLP practice. So in summary, a dual assay allows to extract more data from a given amount of sample in the same time as a singleplex assay. For dual assay, we need to have equipment able to read both assays on black clear bottom plates. We need a fluorescent reader for calcium transient, and we need a luminescence reader for beta-arrestin assay. So we use Hamamatsu FDSS microcell functional drug screening system that is suitable for both assays. There is a loading, this is the equipment up here, you see. There is a loading chamber with a dispensing unit used to inject ligands, and you can have a camera at the bottom of the system capable of measuring fluorescence and luminescence. When looking at the calcium signal generated by histamine receptor, we can see that the 4 histamine receptors are capable to induce intracellular calcium release through IT3 receptor. And for that, histamine receptors have to be coupled either to G-alpha-Q or G-alpha-I beta-gamma subunit to generate a calcium signal. Very recently, Van Unen et al. Have shown that H1 receptor can be coupled to G-alpha-Q, G-alpha-S, and G-alpha-I G-proteins, G-alpha-Q being the main G-protein involved in signaling. In the same paper, the authors show that the G-protein selectivity can be linked to putative bias at the histamine H1 receptor using FRET biosensor. This is summarized in the two figures in the right. But without going too much into details, when compared to the natural ligand histamine, we see that methyl histoprolifen, MHP, the red curves on the figures, show a preference of G-alpha-Q over G-alpha-I. This work suggests that ligand-based signaling can be obtained through the H1 receptor. So to set up the single-plate dual calcium and beta-arrestin assays, we decided to evaluate the DiscoverX beta-arrestin cell line expressing H1 receptor. Because agonists induce receptor desensitization, calcium assay has to be performed first. Injection of histamine agonist is the starting point of the beta-arrestin recruitment assay. This is illustrated in the figure, showing an example of kinetics for beta-arrestin detection. The detection of beta-arrestin recruitment is done at 90 minutes, whereas the measurement of calcium mobilization occurs in 90 seconds. So now the first question to ask when developing the duplex assay is the histamine receptor beta-arrestin cell lines from DiscoverX capable of generating calcium signals. So the cartoon on the left part of the slide, you see the GPCR is fused at its C terminus with a proline tag containing 42 amino acids of beta-galactosidase. Beta-arrestin is fused with the larger part of beta-gal called acceptor. Activation of the GPCR stimulates binding of beta-arrestin to the proline tag, resulting in active beta-galactosidase able to cleave the substrate, leading to chemiluminescence. On the right part of the slide, we have the calcium signaling pathway we described just before, and leading to intracellular calcium release following receptor activation. So the proline tag was constructed to measure beta-arrestin recruitment and should not interfere with calcium signaling pathways. We have studied separately both assay using beta-arrestin H1 expressing cell lines. Here on the left, the figure shows calcium mobilization induced by the natural ligand histamine with an EC50 of 43 nanomolar. Now on the right, the figure shows the beta-arrestin recruitment induced by histamine with an EC50 of 35 nanomolar. The observed signal is antagonized by the specific cetirizine H1 antagonist with a KD of 43 nanomolar. And yes, the H1 cell line is capable to generate signals from both assay. For the dual assay, we have to move forward through different steps. The first one, since calcium assay fluorescence reading at the microcell FDSS requires black plate, we had to check whether black clear bottom plate for beta-arrestin readings is suitable. And second, we had to define compatible plating medium and buffers for both assays. And third, we have to define FDSS microcell settings for calcium and beta-arrestin assays. So number one, we have performed a beta-arrestin assay using black clear bottom plates. Following the recommended beta-arrestin basic protocol and measured the luminescence either on the right part of the slide with microbeta from Perkin-Almer, or with the same experiment but the reading was made on the FDSS and microcell from Hamamatsu. So here you can see that both signals are comparable on the two equipments. So black plate that is favorable for calcium assay is also suitable for β-arrestin recruitment assay on FDSS microcell from Hamamatsu. So number two, we had to define a compatible plating medium for both assays. So for basic β-arrestin assay, it is recommended to use assay complete cell plating 2 reagents, CP2, and for calcium assay, cells are grown in complete culture medium and prior assay. HBSS buffer is used for calcium dye loading. So we wanted to see if the β-arrestin condition could be applied to calcium assay, and we tested several medium combinations. So the first one is a sealing complete medium followed by loading calcium dye in CP2, which is a complete medium used usually for calcium assay and CP2 for β-arrestin. Then we used a calcium combination sealing complete medium. It's a red curve. And the calcium loading dye in HBSS. And finally, we used the β-arrestin conditions. It's a green curve. Sealing and loading calcium with the CP2 medium. And we can see from the results represented in this figure that the three conditions lead to generate comparable signals. So CP2 plating medium used for β-arrestin assay is suitable for calcium flux. And single plate dual assay can then be run on FDSS microcell system. So now regarding the protocol in more details, for cell plating, one day prior to experiment, CHOK1 human H1 β-arrestin cells are harvested with DiscoverX cell detachment reagents and seeded at 20,000 cells per well in 100 microliter in DiscoverX cell plating 2 reagent, the CP2 medium we talked about before. As seen previously, we use a black plate with transparent bottom. For calcium assay, we use 1x304 loading dye solution made in CP2 medium. The dye Cal 520 works also and can be replaced by can replace 304 if needed. So the final concentration of the solution, we have 2 micromolar 304, 0.05% pruronic F127, 1.25 millimolar probenecid, 0.2% DMSO, and no quencher. So to run a calcium assay, CP2 medium is removed and replaced by 100 microliter of 1x304 loading dye solution. Plates are incubated 30 to 45 minutes at 37 degrees in a CO2 incubator. Cells are washed with 200 microliter of HBSS buffer containing calcium, magnesium, 20 millimolar HBS adjusted to pH 7.4. Then 40 microliter of CP2 medium are added. We had then 10 microliter of 10x antagonist when working with antagonist mode with the dilution made in an HBSS buffer, or 10 microliter of CP2 medium when we work on the agonist mode or for the control. Then we follow an incubation of 30 minutes at room temperature. To move on, injection of 10 microliter agonist, the 10x solutions, is made in HBSS buffer, and the injection is proceeded by FDSS head. And the fluorescence reading is during 90 minutes. For the FDSS microcell calcium settings, the pipetting is 10 microliter for the agonist, 10x concentrated. The compound dilutions are made in HBSS buffer. Injection is 10 microliter is done by at 10 microliter per second at 3 millimeter high. The reading is 90 seconds with an exposition of 200 milliseconds, gain 2, 1 second interval, and binning 2x2. Here I have listed some parameters that should be taken into account when doing calcium assay: the dip and rate of agonist injection, the nature and size of considered agonist, aminergic, lipidic, or peptidic ligands, the viscosity of the assay buffer, basic methodology versus no wash kit. And finally, the volume and surface area of the assay, either if it's a full or a half size well. I'm not going to go into much details with these parameters, but I will be happy to discuss later this issue with interested people. So in summary, we recommend high speed and deep delivery close to the cells for agonist testing, and a low speed and delivery above the buffer surface for antagonist testing. This slide summarizes in the DiscoverX node the different steps of the protocol we went through. And we ended the calcium assay where is the red arrow. And at the end of the assay, we follow the basic β-arrestin steps for the detection of β-arrestin recruitment. Looking at the β-arrestin settings on the microcell, we have 10 reading samples with a 10-second interval. Now, let me show you some results we obtained with the histamine H1 receptor, and for the first step, the calcium assay. So, in this slide, is shown the activation of H1 receptor by histamine in an agonist mode. On the right, on the top right, you see the negative control, and you have different concentration of histamine going from right to left, up to 10 micromolar. The figure on the left bottom, we have the different curves plotted together with the fluorescence level in function of the time. And this lead to generate the concentration response curve showing an EC50 of 7 nanomolar for histamine. This slide represents an assay, calcium assay run on antagonist mode. So different cetirizine concentration, which is an H1 antagonist, were applied versus 300 nanomolar of the agonist histamine. So you have the negative control at the bottom line. We have the no cetirizine with 300 nanomolar histamine, which is the top curve with the highest signal. And we can see that increasing concentration of cetirizine inhibits the calcium signal induced by histamine. On the right here in the slide, we have the concentration response curve of histamine with an EC50 of 6.5 nanomolar. We have plotted the inhibition curve for cetirizine, allowing to determine an EC50 and then to calculate a KD of 75 nanomolar by using a Schenck-Prussoff equation. H1 Here I am showing to you the comparison of the two different H1 antagonists with different potencies. On the left, we have a cetirizine antagonist against histamine. And on the right, we have pyrrolamine again against histamine 2. So the different plots that are indicated at the bottom of the slide show a better potency for pyrrolamine versus cetirizine in the calcium assay, with a pyrrolamine a KB of 1.5 nanomolar, whereas cetirizine, as we have seen, is 75 nanomolar. We have then made a histamine H1 ligand profiling using calcium assay. So on the agonist mode, histamine again, as we've seen previously, is able to induce a calcium signal, here with an EC50 of 8 nanomolar, whereas none of the H1 antagonists tested, cetirizine, pyrrolamine, doxepine, and we have tested many more antagonists, they were not able to stimulate the cells. So now, when we have used the antagonist mode, as it is shown in these two figures, the different antagonist H1 antagonists tested are able to antagonize the histamine with different potencies, and some of them with pretty high, pretty low KB. Sorry, for example, tripledine has a KB of 0.5 nanomolar, which is the dark blue curve on the right part of the figure, or maybe doxepine, again on the left curve, the dark blue one with a KB of 1 nanomolar. So the different H1 ligands behave as a potent antagonist in a calcium assay. Now I would like to go into more details regarding calcium assay and GPCR antagonism in drug discovery. When studying antagonists, IC50 are determined and converted into KB by using the Chang-Prusov equation, which is indicated up here. KB is applicable at equilibrium conditions that are not encountered with functional calcium assays. So as suggested by Terekin Akin and others, we propose to use the PA2 as a universal determinant of antagonist potency. By definition, the PA2 equals the minus log of the antagonist concentration, producing a twofold shift of the agonist concentration response curve. So when working at low agonist occupancy, the Ka is far superior to the agonist concentration. So the right part of the figure up here is now negligible, and the above equation can be simplified and having the Pa2 tending towards the PKB. So this figure represents a shield plot using different antagonists versus an agonist response curve. Sorry for the slide. And we see, and these are represented at non-equilibrium conditions. We see concentration response curve dextral displacement, as well as the maximum response reduction. So calculation of PA2 at low agonist response overcome the potential bias associated with non-equilibrium conditions, and it allows to estimate insurmountable antagonist affinity. as explained before, again, the PA2 is a minus log of the antagonist concentration shift of the agonist concentration response curve. So we use a surrogate dose ratio value as surrogate parameter for calculation of PA2 with this formula. PA2 is equals log of dose ratio minus 1 minus log of the antagonist concentration. So that means at dose ratio 2, the PA2 equals minus log of the concentration of the antagonist. So when facing competitive surmountable antagonism at equilibrium, we can use the dose ratio at the EC50, the dot red line appear. And when we have non-competitive and surmountable antagonism at hemi-equilibrium, we have to use the dose ratio at low agonist response, indicated appear on the right part of the figure, the red dot curve. This slide summarizes the different steps we went through and illustrated the shield plot pharmacological method. The dose effect curve for an agonist is determined in the presence of various concentration of competitive antagonists with a dextral displacement of the concentration response curve. And most of the time, reduction of maximum response in non-equilibrium conditions. So by plating log of dose ratio minus 1 in function of the minus log of the concentration of the antagonist, we can calculate the PA2, which tends towards the PKB, as said before. So I have put here a few examples we've generated in-house, showing that it is possible to encounter the two types of antagonists, the different types, sorry, of antagonists listed by Terekin-Akin on the left table. And when we have a competitive surmountable antagonism, we obtain data comparable to that here. We can see also hemi-equilibrium antagonism represented in the right part of the top one figure. And we can also have orthosteric or allosteric and surmountable antagonism here by the two figures up here. So we were able experimentally to reproduce what is described by Thierry and Akin with the different modes. This is an example of the shield plot method used with calcium assay. To determine the death rotary in histamine H1 antagonist potency on NUVAC. And we use a dose ratio at low concentration agonist, showed here by the black dot plot. And we were able to calculate, as mentioned before, the PA2 here at 8.77. Then now the second step concerns histamine H1 receptor with the β-arrestin recruitment assay. We have made histamine H1 ligand profiling using the β-arrestin assay on the agonist mode first. Histamine is able to activate the recruitment of β-arrestin with an EC50 of 68 nanomolar, whereas none of the antagonist H1 tested were not able to generate any signal. So, as you can see, inverse agonism might be observed for H1 antagonist below the zero. Here we have used the antagonist mode, and as seen in the two figures here, different H1 ligands behave as potent antagonists in the beta-arrestin assay with different potencies. We have pretty good Kb with doxepine of 0.5 nanomolar, pyrrolamine at 0.7 nanomolar, tripolidine here at 0.3 nanomolar, and BP4 compound at 1 nanomolar. According to the work performed with histamine at the different H1 antagonists on the duplex assay, we were able to define histamine H1 ligand signature for the different assays. From table from right to left, we have the beta-arrestin results using the DiscoverX CHOK1 human H1 with EC50 for histamine and KB for antagonist. Then we have calcium data with the same cell line, the DiscoverX human H1 cell line. We have calcium data with in-house HEK293 cells, recombinant cells expressing human H1 receptor. And again, calcium data with native UVEX cells. On the left on the table, we have listed the GTP gamma S binding assay using the HEK human H1 recombinant cells. And we have also a binding assay with a truncated methylamine binding. So as you can see, histamine potency varies from 7.2 nanomolar as in EC50 up to 30 micromolar with the GTP gamma S assay. But the best affinity is observed on calcium assay using recombinant cells, either the HEK cells or the beta-arrestin cells. Some H1 antagonists seem to exhibit negative intrinsic activity, as shown here in yellow, indicating a possible H1 constitutive activity on this CHOK1 cells. Hierarchy of the various products tested is somehow equivalent in the different assays. The closest between arrestin and affinity, since arrestin is an unamplified stoichiometric assay. So you can see that, for example, pyrrolamine, doxepine, or the BP4 are quite comparable in the different assays. If I take doxepine, we have 0.1 nanomolar on binding assay, 0.2 on GTP gamma S binding assay, 1 nanomolar with calcium flux using the DiscoverX cell line, and 0.2 nanomolar with the beta-arrestin recruitment. And finally, within calcium assay, histamine potency is dependent on the H1 expressing cells, native versus recombinant. And you can see here that we can go up from 7.2 nanomolar up to 1.7 micromolar with a native UVAC. Regarding the discrepancy of histamine potency, in this figure is illustrated the importance of GPCR expressing cells when looking at the calcium response. On the left figure, you see the calcium signal induced by histamine on the recombinant human H1 expressing cells with a C50 of 7 nanomolar. And on the right part, the same kind of experiment with native human H1 express in the native cells, UVEC. And you see that the EC50 is much more important at 1.7 micromolar. So we can raise several hypotheses to explain such discrepancy. Involvement of receptor reserve, agonist induced structural modifications, post signaling regulation. I have to mention too that with UVEC cells, we observe several stimulating waves appear, and that the signal never goes back to the basal level, as it was for the HEK cells. So now this cartoon illustrates what happened upon stimulation of the histamine H1 receptor. When activated by histamine, the receptor is able to transduce the signal through the canonical G-protein signaling, going through G-alpha-Q as we've seen previously, and leading to intracellular calcium release. Then the receptor is phosphorylated by G-protein receptor kinase, and mainly the kinase 2. And it has been well described in the recent paper published by Ishinuma and collaborators in this year, showing that the short 17 amino acid C-terminus, as well as some threonine and serine located in intracellular loops, are involved in the H1 receptor internalization. So the receptor, we obtain internalization, GRK, arrestin, clathrin mediated. And at that point, we can obtain specific beta-arrestin signaling, either directly from the cell membrane or going through the internal vesicles. Again, Ishimura, in a previous paper, has shown that calcium-calmodulin complex can transiently inhibit at early stage of agonist stimulation the internalization of the receptor. It shows up here by the red line. And this might explain why we observe the sustained histamine stimulation with the UVEC cells that I showed you in the previous slide. So, to summarize, beta-arrestin cell lines expressing H1 receptor provided robust responses by detecting histamine-induced beta-arrestin recruitment. To measure both fluorescence and luminescence, use of black clear bottom microplate calcium as well as CP2 plating medium beta-arrestin is highly recommended. Single plate dual calcium and beta-arrestin assay have been implemented for H1 receptor expressing beta-arrestin cell line. Strong fluorescence signal, calcium, as well as luminescence for beta-arrestin signals were recorded. Histamine H1 antagonist profiling can be obtained regarding beta-arrestin recruitment and calcium mobilization. The use of PA2 as a determinant of antagonist potency to overcome the potential bias associated with non-equilibrium conditions, and implementation of a single plate dual assay in other beta-arrestin cell lines expressing receptors coupled to calcium signaling. I've listed some of the cell lines that might be of interest to anybody, I have put here my email address for these who would like to get additional details. I thank you very much for your attention. We'll be very happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Calmels, for that informative presentation. It is now time for Q&A. If you have a question you would like to ask Dr. Calmels, please do so now. Just click on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window, type your question into the box that appears on your screen, and click the send button. We'll answer as many of your questions as we have time for. If we happen to run out of time before we get to your question, we will be sure to answer your question via email after the presentation. Let's get started. Our first question is, Dr. Calmels, why are the diffusion parameters important for calcium mobilization?
Okay. It is important because it influences the time for the compound to reach the cells, and this has some impact on the drug potency and efficacy, finally. In the calcium transient experiment, we have to be as close as possible to equilibrium conditions. And this is why some parameters can be important. For example, depth and rate of agonist injection, this has to be carefully determined for each pair of receptor ligands, which most of the time people don't do that. For example, when studying an antagonist, depending on what are your injection parameters that you set up, you can obtain very different KBA calculated values. So this is, for me, very important. Another aspect is the nature and size of the agonist that you use. If you have a small molecule, or this can behave differently compared to a lipid or a large peptide, the time for which the target, the receptor. And also, I found myself that viscosity of the medium is important. If you use no-wash kits, this is highly viscous, and the compounds may have some difficulties to reach the bottom of the well and then reach a receptor.
Now, Dr. Calmels, to be at equilibrium, have you tested assays as IP1?
Not really. I'm not working on IP1 directly. I am more focused on calcium directly flux.
Which cell line, native or recombinant, would you recommend to record H1-induced calcium transients?
Oh, I see. Actually, it does not matter as long as you calculate KB values, because KB values for antagonist that I've shown in the table slide, that the KB values we obtain for an antagonist are the same, as comparable with both cell line, either the recombinant cell line HEK or the UVEC native. Of course, if you want to perform a dual β-arrestin assay, it's better to use a recombinant cell, because you will need a lot of cells. And UVAC cells, if you don't prepare the cells yourself, might be quite difficult to buy in the long term. So I would recommend, if possible, to use recombinant cells for when performing a lot of different assays.
Dr. Calmels, are you performing all β-arrestin assays at 90 minutes?
And you mean the endpoint? At DiscoverX, the endpoint for measuring assay is recommended for each cell line, and this is quite important. But sometimes you can also look at yourself more carefully and see if for example, 90 minutes for the H1 is accurate or not. Maybe sometimes you may have to work a little bit longer or a bit shorter. Something that also can be interesting is maybe perform some kinetics analysis. Since some drugs may behave differently in terms of efficacy and in function of the time, of course. I don't know if it's answering the question, but.
Can we use white 96 well plates that are recommended for arrest and detection for this duplexed assay?
Actually, when performing beta arrestin assays, it is recommended to use 96 white plate for luminescence recording. But actually, it's not highly suitable for fluorescence readings because there is a strong autofluorescence background with the white plate. So black plate that we use are suitable for both fluorescence and luminescence. And we have shown that it is also working for luminescence with the beta-arrestin assay. The signal measured is a little bit reduced compared to white plates, but there is no influence on the results.
Can luminescence or fluorescence be read simultaneously in your detection platform?
Actually, not simultaneously. Simultaneously, you have to work first with the fluorescence when performing calcium assay with the FDSS microcell platform, and then when the recording is finished, which is a couple of minutes in time duration, then you can switch to with the FDSS microcell to the luminescence signal, and then you can record as long as you want the cells.
Now, Dr. Calmels, why is HVSS buffer not used for both assays?
It's indeed we use regularly HVSS buffer for calcium transients in the lab. In this duplex protocol, we have privileged the arrestin assay, which work with a specific medium as recommended by the PathHunters. And we have control that the calcium transients can be also measured using the same medium. In some preliminary experiments, we have observed that beta arrestin do not work perfectly well when using HBSS buffer. So I would not recommend using the HBSS buffer for running both assays. The medium recommended in the PathHunters, excuse me, is probably the best that can be done.
We've had some great questions coming in, but I believe we have time for just one more. This will have to be our last. Dr. Calmels, okay. What are the strengths of the FDSS U cell for calcium imaging?
What is the strength? what is interesting with this platform is that you can perform kinetic studies using either the 96 well plates that I'm using, or you can even use 384 well plates. And another strong advantage is compared to different other instruments is the possibility to inject simultaneously the compound in the whole well at the same time. And another good point is you can have a temperature control, and you can also set up two injection steps. So if you want to inject first the antagonist and second the agonist or whatever,
two different drugs, you can do two times injection. And to me, this equipment is very, very interesting when performing calcium assay and kinetic studies.
I would like to once again thank Dr. Thierry Calmels for his presentation. Oh. Dr. Calmels, do you have any final comments for our audience?
No. I would like just to thank you, everybody, for their attention. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Calmels. And thank you, too, also our sponsor, DiscoverX, for making today's broadcast possible. Before we go, I would like to let everyone know that today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through May 9th, 2017. You will receive an email from Labroots letting you know when this webcast will be available for replay. Please share that announcement with your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. That's all for now.
That's all for
thanks for joining us. We hope to see you again soon. Goodbye.